Bienvenidos a esta edición de Escépticos en el PAB, que somos escépticos, pero ya no estamos en el PAB, por circunstancias, el local donde solemos hacerlo habitualmente, tenían otra cosa, el que teníamos de resguardo también tenían otra cosa, y bueno, nos han acogido aquí, no tenemos las cervezas, pero en esta ocasión no hace falta porque viene un invitado de excepción, el señor Sarán, que no hace falta que lo presente, porque es conocidísimo. Estoy seguro que todos los que estamos aquí habéis visto los vídeos en YouTube, viendo las noticias. La CNN salió hace poco, un reportaje. Y sobre todo, para mí, el que es su vídeo más famoso, en el que sobrevive a la muerte por una especie de brujo que decía que era capaz de matarlo. Y Sarán, pues no, consiguió sobrevivir. Pero aunque los poderes espirituales no tengan tantos poderes, es decir, si yo ahora blasfemo no me va a caer un rayo para castigarme, por desgracia los representantes o los supuestos representantes de Dios en la Tierra sí que tienen herramientas para hacer difícil la vida a las personas. Y él tiene una condena por blasfemia en la India, una asociación católica, por el simple hecho de desmontar un supuesto milagro. No es que haya hecho una caricatura ofensiva, no es que se haya ido a una iglesia y haya profanado un templo, no, simplemente un supuesto milagro lo ha desmontado, y eso ha sido suficiente para que tenga que estar en exilio y no pueda volver a su país. Para él es un tema muy importante, el tema de la separación iglesia-estado, que supongo que es muy importante para todos los que estamos aquí. Aquí también hemos tenido cosas de estas, a Leo Bassi, también una asociación que hizo un proceso por blasfemia. Bueno, no hace falta que digamos que aquí la iglesia tiene un poder, porque también supuestamente es un estado laico, en la realidad no es así. Y bueno, yo soy ateo, no tengo nada en contra de la gente que es creyente, pero sí que pienso que debería respetar la acción de las personas que son ateas, y sobre todo que una cosa es el Estado, otra cosa es la Iglesia, y todos los Estados deberían ser. Y esa es la lucha, ese es el objetivo de la gira que tiene Sarán por toda España, y que empieza hoy, aquí en Barcelona, con su charla para el Pido, pues por favor, un fuerte aplauso.
First of all, I'm so sorry that I cannot speak in Spanish, which is a wonderful language. And unfortunately, I mean, I'm not familiar with this language. Though there's a rationalist bulletin still coming in Spanish language also, but it's done by some other people. As you know, I come from India, but at this moment I don't live in India, but in Finland. There's a special reason for that thing, as you may also know. Despite my continuous work in India for last 3 decades, because there was a very major social necessity to do certain things in India. Come to that thing very specifically. Because 1950s, India was having a very special situation. The situation was very simple, that India was having an enormously large population, as you know. 1.2 billion people lived there. It's quite a large population. But 60 years back, we had still half the population. In 60 years, we doubled the population. 1950s, India's major problem was, India had still half of 1.2 billion people, but there was not enough wheat or rice in India. There was no communication facilities proper in India. India was just a new nation, got liberated from British regime in 1947. And to feed the whole people, there was money, but there was no wheat, there was no rice. That was the situation. But 1960s saw a dramatic change in India. Most of the people know India about the poor India, but India is not like that. 1960s, the dramatic change that happened in India, we called the Green Revolution in India. Science and technology came in support of it. First time we saw the meaning of science and technology. Agricultural production has multiplied 200 times in a span of 5 years. The seed development, irrigation, water management, communication, road, everything has dramatically changed. And now, for example, from 1950s, late 1950s, when we had no wheat and waiting for American ships or Australian ships to come to bring the wheat, now India, with double the population, has excess wheat and rice in storage for the next 7 years in the food godowns. And agriculture production is enormously successful, that the majority of the people live in the rural India, and it's really successful. It's so cheap, enormously produced. The dramatic revolution that happened with the aid of science and technology was in 1960s. But parallelly, there was another thing happened in India, the same period. That is what we have been fighting against. I come to that straight away. 1960s came in Indian scene, a person namely Maharishi Maheshwari. Maharishi Maheshwari was a person who was very popular in Europe at that time. Not in India, but in Europe. He was trying to sell an idea, namely transcendental meditation, TM, he called it, as a trademark. And this has been becoming a trademark of India. Why? Mainly because the kind of people he got as disciples, like Beatles. And you know what he did in India? He did not do anything in India, but he just lived in Amsterdam and sold India in a very different way, to exoticize India to the West. That was his idea. He said people there can fly. But he from the say. He showed pictures of people. And this is the yogic flying school of transcendental meditation. And I mean, this was from a brochure of Mahesh Yogi only. And then he had a special school in Switzerland where the students are fighting. But, you know, these kind of things got enormous currency all over the world. And with this small technique of flying, he got quite a lot of money to buy huge centers in America, in Amsterdam, in Switzerland, everywhere in Europe. And you know what he did? It was a very simple thing. To his ashram, which he made in Amsterdam or elsewhere, when you go there, you know, why did he do this thing also? He said that he was doing this thing for when people levitate like this, there's a positive vibration immediately going, the typical language of all these people, which would make world peace. And then he made a lot of scientific charts and gave huge advertisements to say how the levitation and positive vibration makes world peace and the golden era is beginning. People believed. But back in India, where he tried to sell this idea from, he started in 1960s. In 1962, there was no global peace, but India immediately got into a war with China. 1964, the second war with Pakistan. 1970, the third war with Pakistan. In the span of 10 years, we had three great wars, despite his yogi flying and trying to get global peace out of that. But the trick was very simple. What he did was, you have to pay $2,500 to get a session of yoga training. Register with them, and once you pay that, you get a special eatery which is known as the prasad. Prasad is when you go to any temple, you get some little eatery which you can eat. And after that, you'll be taken to a down cellar room, which is dark. You have to sit in the lotus position, and of course, then you get not a default mantra, but a specially explicit mantra for you. Mantra is a chanting word. Very simple, like one mantra, one of the journalists who go was Om Kri Kri. That's three words, just without any meaning. And he gets it on a piece of paper, and he is asked to pronounce it properly. Okay, done. Then he is asked to sit in lotus position, close the eyes, eat the prasad beforehand, and repeat it a million times. And you know what happens in this little room? There is later allegation that this prasad that he has been giving contained hashish. But of course, one gets real high and one feels really fly. Without hashish, also one will fly. That's the whole thing. Because when you sit in such a room, close room, with lack of oxygen in the room, the oxygen content in your blood goes down, and supply of oxygen goes down in the brain. You know what happens? You are absolutely prone to hallucinations. Any kind of thing that you imagine, when there is lack of oxygen in your brain, you can hallucinate. And you are completely in a hallucinogenic mood. And we have trained some other people in the same kind of conditions to see how they feel, if they feel fine. We gave another word, garbage. The guy repeated garbage, 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 a million times, but half the time he felt he's fine, without even hashish. So this is what he told, and that became one of the trademarks of India in the old version. But in the 1970s, another person emerged. The first televisions came in India, government-owned television. And this person was dominating the television scene at the time. Every morning, from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock, he would come to the television screen and say that how with yoga, with the exotic positions and gestures which he saw in the television, so all of the Indian televisions at that time, black and white television run by the government at that time. And could see everywhere people simply sitting in yogic positions, because that would immediately help you with the arthritics and all these kind of problems. But most of the time what happens is, yoga is a good exercise, but if it's not practiced regularly from your childhood, and suddenly when you start in the adulthood, and it's too much, you know, there are two kinds of exercise. One is the heart pumping exercise, the other is the stretching exercise. The stretching exercises normally can get you in great trouble if you have cervical spondylosis, for example. And you can simply get hospitalized. And a lot of people get caught into, you know, the exotic positions people try without any training or continuous practice. And this was propagated in Indian television so lively. But the problem was, this guy was not for global peace. He owned a gun factory. And that was in Jammu and Kashmir. And he was going in later, in late 1970s, flying there with his own helicopter, but with illegal ammunition, and it got burst at head. Is over. But still more people, you know, these are the people who controlled India for a long time. Chandraswami. Chandraswami is arrested later because he had enormous proximity to the Prime Minister of India, P.V. Narasimha Rao, that was later Prime Minister of India. But Narasimha Rao was a powerful education minister and foreign minister in 1960s and 70s, and he had been very, very close to him. Personal astrologer of Narasimha Rao. The proximity he used to use to sell, for example, licenses to businessmen and other people. And of course, one pickle empire owner of the United States gave him a lot of money, thinking that the Prime Minister is going to get him a big license in India to produce it. And he didn't get it. And the complaint was there, and he was arrested. But before the arrest, he tried to provoke a great magic in India, to scare the whole people. Because he is supposed to be the controller of a special god in India, namely Ganesh. Ganesh is a very special god in India, with an elephant face and a human body. And he is the invoker of Ganesh, that's generally believed. And before he got arrested, in India we had a great miracle happening in India. Ganesh milk miracle, 1995, September 24. You know, that's a very interesting, the god itself is a very interesting character. As per the mythology, I'm not making joke at Ganesh, but as per the real mythology of Indian belief system, he is the son of another god named Shiva. Shiva is a very famous god with a third eye and controller of all destruction. Tsunamis and tempests and all are controlled by Shiva. But Shiva got this son. And He's a very big angry person. One day he got completely angry with his son, he chopped off his head and put into fire. Later he understood that the anger was no meaning, I mean, because it was for a wrong understanding, but his head has gone. What's to be done? So he looked for another head to be fixed in, and he found an elephant running over there, and she got the head cut off and stitched on his head, and he got the elephant. That's the belief system. I mean, many people seriously believe it, still many people. I mean, urban cities, I don't think people believe it seriously. But Ganesh is seen everywhere, it's a new cult in India, as a person, or it's a very personified god for many people, who is helping you to break all obstacles in your progress. Therefore, when India launches a satellite to the space, the chief of Indian space communication goes there and break a coconut at the auspicious hour to please the elephant god and stop the obstacles going. Sometimes it comes down also. But most of the time successful, but not because of Ganesh, but because India has a lot of fine scientists. But here what happened was, 1995, Chandra Swami announced that a miracle is going to happen. And it happened exactly. Every temple in the morning, the Ganesh statue started drinking milk. Every temple means every single temple in India, that's a Ganesh statue. Either in the most prominent position or as a secondary god. There are 3,000 plus gods in India. And Ganesh is very, very prominent, right? And when I reached my office, there were television people already waiting in my office. Explain what, how is it happening? I didn't know what was happening. I said, I don't have a ready-made answer for every miracle that happened, because that's what many televisions believe. But I went with them to the temple to see what was happening. And I found a lot of people in queue and carrying milk. Quite a long queue in the nearby temple. And people have been feeding milk in this pool. And I went close and I looked. To my surprise, milk has vanished. People feed the milk in this pool. The moment it touches the mouth, as if the god is sucking the whole milk out, it simply vanishes from this pool. And more and more people brought milk, and it was just, the Ganesh god seemed so thirsty everywhere. He was drinking and drinking milk everywhere, tons and tons of milk. And still, it was drinking. But I have no answer how to explain this thing. But I thought, I mean, the only way is to try it, I mean, with the other statues. I went back to my office, asked the television people to wait outside, and I looked for some statue somewhere. Then I found a bust of Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India, whom I liked very much because he was a very scientific-oriented person. I mean, almost absolute skeptic or rationalist, can be called. Nehru's bust I had as a student, onwards I was keeping on my cupboard. So I took Nehru's small bust from my table. It was very famous as Nehru liked coffee very much. And I just thought, how did they did it? I remember. And I put some coffee over his head. And in a spoon, I gave some coffee to Nehru. And yes, Nehru was drinking coffee also. Then I thought, I mean, maybe I should try a little bit more interesting thing. I mean, I looked for a Mahatma Gandhi statue. I didn't have one. One of my neighbors had one, and we got a Mahatma Gandhi statue. Gandhi was absolutely titular. I mean, who can drink alcohol? I cannot imagine the taste. Telling such a thing in India would be such a big offense. He would not even cow's milk because that was meant for the calf only. And such a guy Gandhi was. And I thought, what would be the most interesting thing? To give some beer to Mahatma Gandhi. So I looked for some beer, but still there was some beer in my fridge, and I just gave one spoonful of beer to Mahatma Gandhi, and he drank beer too. So the idea was very clear what was happening. Any statue anywhere, in a given situation, you give a spoonful of any liquid to drink it. How will it drink? It's very simple. The spoon, when it is full, it's in a curved position, it's a surface tension. And when it touches the wet statue, the surface tension breaks from that point. Mm-hmm. Then it simply drains down. Mm-hmm. But it's not going inside, but it simply goes over the body and go down. I wanted to be very sure. I went to the drain and looked. Just milk was flowing. Then the whole milk was going down. The whole was wet, and it was all coming through the body and coming down, and it was simply going through the drain. And we took a lot of photographs of the drain with the milk running and running. So it was all very clear what was happening. But then we decided to counter it so effectively. That's the first time we knew that our movement is very powerful. I suddenly telephoned all the people who could communicate through local television. We have 29 languages in India, and different television channels maintain, and to communicate, you need a lot of people. So I explained how to do this thing, but not to provoke people with the Gandhi or Nehru or anything, but really take a Ganesh statue. First give milk, give little white milk, then with color, pigmented milk, blue or red color, do it again, and then you can see where the milk is going. So, and talk to television people and speak in the television delay. I appeared in two major national television, and a lot of other people worked in the local television, they all went. We all explained when this was reported as a great thing in the evening, when a million tables this was celebrated during the day. And by evening, we heard that in UK, 5 hours later, there is, morning in UK, and the whole Indian temples have been doing the same thing. And by evening it's America, there is morning, and they also start Ganesh statues are drinking milk. But in India, the miracle is over. Just explained it. The statues drinking it properly. And Chandra Swami has been the beginner of this thing, because he announced this thing. But it went out of his hands. Nobody knew that it was he who started it, because he wanted to scare people. But it took its own mechanism, and it went as a very big thing and became the greatest Indian miracle. And the greatest show of Indian rationalism, how we can stop such a thing. That was one good position we have to understand things very well. But that's one side of things. This is another gentleman whose name is Satish Saibaba. He became another trademark of India in the same period, 1960s. 50s he emerged in the public scene. 60s he became very, very powerful. You know, he thought he himself was good. At least he claimed. He wrote a book named Satyam Sivam Sundaram, is the name of the book, wherein one chapter begins like this: I am the God, I created this universe. He created this world. And you know, it was not taken as a joke. People were all around politics. But not just people. Later, of course, the God has been abused or deified. There are a lot of people coming out, the disciples still were abused. But we have people like him. You know, the people here. He is Atal Bihari Vajpayee, the Prime Minister of India. He is Chandra Babu Naidu, the chief minister of the state where he is living. He was living. So look at that, the prime minister and the state chief minister folding hands in front of the God. And the God is just, okay, consoled out. And he had enormous influence. You know, in terms of money, he had 3 times more money than the state that he had. And he had his own airport, international airport, for guests to come. They travel only once abroad to see Idi Amin, his close friend in Uganda. And otherwise, head of the nations came all the way to see him. From Sri Lanka, to Mahim, a lot of countries. And he had his own railway station, his own university, so many colleges, hospitals, institutions, and of course he was a, he liked cricket. But he had his own cricket stadium. He paid all his great cricket stars, and they all came and played there at his cricket stadium, and he would be the only person or maybe 5-6 people sitting and seeing him there. And then he was very happy and he would go back. And that was how the God was. And when he died, this was before the body was covered with the national flag, later it was covered with the national flag. Sitting here is the present Prime Minister of India, Manmohan Singh. And here is Sonia Gandhi, the chief of the Congress Party, who is the head of the ruling party. I don't think these people are devotees, to be very fair to them. Most of these people are doing it for political expediency. Because Manmohan Singh is a devout Sikh religious. And Sonia Gandhi, though she is a Roman Catholic by birth, she tries to pretend that she is a Hindu to win Indian masses. She goes to Ganges River, Ganges, and puts water, I mean special milk, pour into that thing and do all kind of Hindu ceremonies and all. Because to win Indian mindset, she never goes to a church, but goes to temples only. But goes to Sathya Sai Baba because there were a lot of people and that looked like political power connected to that. But that gave credence to this person. Not only those people, very respected people. He is Abdul Kalam, a former president of India, was a space scientist. And this was his birthday. And you know, during his birthday, now he gave him a little poetry which he has written in the satellite. Later it was published also. The poetry says that this earth is such a beautiful world in the solar system. But it is blessed not because of its special beauty, but because Sathya Sai Baba was born there.
He writes a poetry.
I mean, it's bad poetry, of course, but he tried one for Sathya Sai Baba. And what was he? He was a professor of aerospace engineering, first chancellor of space science and technology, 11th president of India, and Bharat Ratna, means the Pearl of India. That's the highest civilian award one would ever get. So that gave a lot of credential to people like Sathya Sai Baba who created this universe. But other people, the spectrum of Indian, the other side of India, the scientific India on one side, I was trying to show the other side only. Asharam Bhakti, he owns nearly 200 schools. The holy man. He don't consider that he is God, but he's the medium to God. A lot of people go to him and then he becomes hysterical, dancing and all, you know, when God enters in his body. And people believe that he's a very great guy. But later, it was found that he was doing a kind of special magic. In Indian belief system, there's a lot of black magic or white magic, whatever it is. It's all written in the mythology, how to get enormous power, how to run an aeroplane, etc. But you cannot really fly one, but people had great fantasies. And of course, there was, flying machines in Indian mythology. Of course, it was tied up with some horses and with wings, and otherwise they could not imagine. Like the present-day science technology, ancient literature also had a lot of things. But he tried to sell an idea that one of the major things the witchcraft practitioners are selling is not to get you success, but to destroy your enemy. Especially businessmen are going to these people to find some solution to defeat the enemy. And one of the ancient literature in India about black magic says that there is a special mixture to be made where the liver of a boy between the age of 7 and 9 is a part of that day. Or fingers to be part of that, like the witchcraft which existed here. But interestingly, in his boys' hostel, some boys were missing and the dead bodies were later found in the toilet or something like that. Postmortem was not done in most of the cases and the bodies were discovered. But then there was a public outcry, the bodies were taken up and postmortem was done. We found that most of them lost their liver. It is very clear for businessmen, he has been actually kidnapping his own students from the hostels, killing them for huge money apparently given by them. And then there was a huge public outcry, all televisions were fighting against him and you know, people were throwing stones at his schools and all. But some days later he was with the Prime Minister. So the whole public opposition suddenly came down because the Prime Minister, and he explains to the Prime Minister that this is all bad things done by people only. Or here is another man who was arrested for raping more than 180 devotees. Such a young man. Anybody who would come as a devotee, the first thing he would do is he would do some. There is a very special form of hashish, the food form of hashish, namely ganja. It is part of the Hindu belief system. And he gives them a mixture of this thing, and then he just take them and rape them.
Many of them came out and he was arrested. But he was a holy man, now he's in Nobel class. Here's another lady whose name is the Hugging Saint, Amma. She's all around Europe every year. Around something like December or something like that, she will come to Europe. I heard that in Finland when she came there to get a hug from her, people have been queuing. It was half a kilometer long or something like that. She is so unpopular a person in Israel, nobody knows. Recently, her foreign donations were stopped by government because she collected a lot of money for tsunami rehabilitation. The money was diverted to build her own institutions. Then the donations were stopped by government about some months back. Or there's another allegation that she has a medical college, and for getting an admission to medical college, a private medical college, is very difficult to get because if you don't have good marks and get into government medical college, you have to go to private medical colleges. And most of these religious institutions or charity institutions, there are medical colleges because we get a lot of black money to get admission there. And $600,000 worth of money is what is to be paid to get an admission to school, or black money. It's all well known, everybody knows, publicly spoken. I know one of my friend's son also has got admission there by paying his money. But in the same hospital, there are nearly 1,500 nurses working. And as per the law, the nurses have a salary in Indian money. Its minimum salary which is to be given to a nurse is 1,400 rupees per month. She gets signature from all the nurses for 1,400 rupees. There's a lot of unemployment among the nurses. And then she gives 2,500 rupees cash. And they complained, and they made a little demonstration to get the money correctly because somebody promoted it. And the goons send out to break the public demand of money. And it was all in television. All televisions were actively speaking about that. But that's one side of that. The other side is a bunch of claims. For example, there is a website named Amachi.com. Amachi is a nickname for Amma. Amma means mother. New Mexico group of the Hugging Saint. I think the article was still there. Where in the tsunami money collection time, she said that she was standing on the 7th floor of her ashram. She has a 7th floor ashram. The top of it, then she saw the great tsunami wave come. Then she decided, okay, it should be stopped. And she takes out her sari and throws it. And the sari is which flows and flows, and it touches the wave and it stops there. And that's why we didn't have tsunami affecting the western coast of India. It's written there. So she could do that, but she didn't look at the other side, eastern side. But the tsunami happened mainly because there was an earthquake in Bali, the other side of the continent. Did not come to the western side. Though her ashram was very close to the south western side, some little waves of course came there, and boundary walls has fallen, and 3 people have died there also. But despite that, she made such claims, and there are gullible people believing anything. Okay? She got a lot of money, really a lot of money in different accounts everywhere. But officially, those money came to India, from the India government puts now very fake. And there we found that more than 85% of the money was just diverted for other things. It never reached the victims. This is what she does as a blessing. She has now helped nearly 10 million people, she claims, and maybe want to come in the Guinness Catch report. So. But how she started was a very interesting thing. Her own autobiography speaks about that thing. How these are the kind of people, you know, very, very interesting people that we have. She was. In her, you know, she speaks my own mother tongue. India has 29 languages. My mother tongue is a small language called Malayalam in Kerala. Kerala is a southern tip of India. I was born there, later I was living in Delhi. She comes from Kerala. And there's a book about her, a penguin named the Black Madonna. And where she writes one page in Malayalam language, one line, her handwriting is given. The handwriting in Malayalam means only one thing. All my devotees, I give you all a great hug. But 4 spelling mistakes in such a sentence. That's how the word writes. And because she cannot even write her own mother tongue, because she's absolutely uneducated person. She cannot speak a single sentence correctly. All what she can do is, anybody comes, she would not speak a single sentence, grab it. But she started at a very young age, and her parents thought she was crazy. They've written in her book also. At the age of 15, she around the birthday time, she won this problem. That, you know, India is a very repressed society, unlike Europe. You can imagine how repressed it is in rural areas. For example, if you travel in a bus, the lady sits there, the two seats are empty there, no guy would sit there. And if a guy sits there, the lady will really stand up. That kind of a social repression is there between the genders. And for example, you cannot imagine in many rural places that girls and boys can shake at each other. It can be taken as a very bad thing. But there are exclusive girls' schools and exclusive boys' schools and all are existing in India. So in such a repressed situation, this girl at the age of 15 suddenly got a crazy idea that any boy passing through the road, she would just jump and run and fuck. And the society found it very, very complicated. But some people ran off. They got a public outrage. Then she would scream and cry and fall down on the floor and make a lot of sounds. And then she was taken to a psychiatric treatment. Well, of course, then she had a lot of things. She would climb on a tree and try to jump. Because some boys should come down to her. This kind of issues were there at the time. But eventually, when she got 18 years or 19 years, a small group emerges about her. Maybe because she would sing and dance and all, dress up like Hindu gods and dance and sing and all. And then some guys are around her and there's a small prayer group begins. But then suddenly this group gets a leader who is the vice president of this cult now. He was a dropout from Satish Sai Baba's ashram, one of the persons there. He was looking for a god who can be controlled easily. In his hands should be. Sai Baba had little more clout and even some people objected. Because Sai Baba was very strict. Very strict in the sense that though he controlled all this money and he had a huge trust controlling the whole thing, he signed the checks by himself. The gods himself signed the check in the last moment. He never allowed anybody else to sign a check. So things are a little difficult. Of course, when Sai Baba died, all the monies were with him. His bedroom was full of studded diamonds and gold and all, and the bed was made of pure gold. And under the bed there were sheets of gold kept in gold. But she was not like that. The guy who promoted her, the person, vice president of this cult, an educated person, was in Satish Sai Baba's ashram, and he tried to make some little advances in the control of monies and all, and he was thrown out. He fought. And then the new cult begins, projecting her as a great goddess. And it worked. Now she is completely under the control of this gentleman. And he speaks for her. And I have heard a very interesting speech of her. Very interesting because she speaks in Malayalam language and I can understand that language. And the guy speaks, interprets in English. And that was in a very interesting meeting abroad. And I saw the video clip. She says that, oh fools, she's so happy sometimes. And okay, everybody don't understand anything. You all think that I am goddess. I'm not one. I'm just a crazy lady. She speaks in pure Malayalam, and then the guy says that, you know, the interpretation is as follows. When you consider me as a god, you befool yourself, because god is yourself inside you, and that's a great Indian philosophy says that god and you are synonymous. That's interpretation. So this way of interpretation keeps on going, and she reached United Nations recently, and she was addressing United Nations as the only lady who heads a religious group. And she comes from a backward community. And a person in a hierarchical caste structure, he is a lady who comes up from a backward community and leads a leader. So United Nations invite her for the lecture. And World Nations representatives and ambassadors listen to her. That's how things are taken from India. There's another person. His name is Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. Sri means sir. He puts his own name as Sri Sri, Sir Ravi Shankar. Okay. But he says, another. He was a teacher at Maheshwar, this Maharshi Mahesh Yogi, whom I have shown first, whom got Beatles as disabled, as a teacher there, later dropped out and started his own group. First he said that how we should really breathe is not exactly how we are really breathing. So what we breathe, the way we breathe is wrong. And the ancient texts explain us how to breathe properly. And he explored it from some ancient texts, but immediately he patented it, the method. And he gives a name for that, it's Sudarsana Kriya. And also it's trademarked. It's highly commercialized, that's it. Then he has groups everywhere, in every city he has groups. And where you can go and study how to breathe properly. But you have to pay money. I know that in every, for example, in Delhi, every Saturday, Sunday, there are groups in most of the schools rented out, and the urban middle class people go there and study to breathe properly. And paying a fee. And then after the first level of breathing technique controlled, and then you get in the second level, third level, he himself would groove, and of course, you have to send him a maintain quite some money to study properly breathing. And that's a very successful business that he made. But he has another approach which attracts a lot of people. He says that he's a feel-good coach, basically. He says that one should be extremely happy and joyful all the time. And to be happy and joyful, what one has to do is close the eyes to all miseries. So if you see any kind of misery, just close your eyes on that side and look at the other side and be merry. And you know, he tried it. Whenever there was an earthquake in Gujarat, people have been died and he was gone there. And he said to all the people, oh, your relatives have died at all, just don't think about them. Just dance in happiness. Chased him.
Yeah.
But in some places it was. Because especially people who don't want to look around, these people who got suddenly a lot of money and want to be comfortable with this thing, they don't want to think about other people. They feel very happy about this new philosophy. Don't look at misery, just be joyous. So he calls his cult art of living. And he sells the technique of breathing. And of course, here is the Prime Minister of India, and here is Goldman Sachs. Here is another Goldman, very famous guy, Baba Ramdev. He cannot be really called a Goldman, but he is a yogic teacher in a way. 10 years back, he was on a bicycle selling, Ayurvedic products. But now he runs an empire that has headquarters in Manhattan and a branch in Sydney and all these places. And he sells again special cure for things. Like this is, he calls a television channel. And he comes every day morning and shows this special guest. And you know, this special guest is very important. If you hold like this for 1 hour every day morning, you don't get old. He tells it damn seriously. And the age affecting on you will be completely controlled by that. You go to any park in New Delhi in the morning and go for a morning walk, you can see some people sitting. Or he comes, he has special cures for everything he found from ancient texts of India. He says, you have to rub your hands like this. That means if you do that, you don't get gray. The hair would never get gray. If you find some hair getting gray, you have to rub long time. But go in a metro in Delhi. You see a lot of people rubbing and rubbing. And it's taken seriously, you know. But okay, rubbing hands and expecting that one would not get gray, I mean, of course, even if you get gray, you know that cognitive dissonance would immediately blow up, telling that something was mistaken, I would probably not say properly. But that is less dangerous. But dangerous was, he tried to sell that with yogic techniques and eating some special leaves, you can control HIV virus. Or when swine flu, H1N1 virus was spreading everywhere in the world, he simply came on his television channel and said that you don't have to have any protection needed. All what you have to do is there's a special leaf named Tulsi. Eat the Tulsi leaf and chant a mantra. And the mantra he announces in the television. How dangerous it is. How dangerous. Instead of arresting this guy for making a public damage, the next day Delhi government started distributing this special leave. That's the situation that we have in India. But that's only one side of things. For example, there's another special technique to come out of ailments, which is duties. But it has immediate response, you know. Younger generation continuing it immediately. Or, but then with this technique, this is again from a brochure of Baba Ramdev. Here, he meantime, he got a lot of money out of these things. He purchased recently an island in Scotland. And there he is, I mean, his success in diversity is coming. Weight reduction yoga. And this is the advertisement for that. All what he has to do is go there, get to his island, pay a lot of money, sit like this for some hours. Done. And it sounds very well, I was told. A lot of people are going there. There are other people, like these are. This is Payat Baba. He is claiming that everybody in India, all his government do everything for global peace, nothing less than that. He gets buried under the earth or sit under the water for 3-4 days. Yeah. 4 days, imagine, under the water. And the first time when he claimed that he would sit under the water, that was in 1995. I've been coming up exposing these kind of people, and the correspondent of independent newspaper in Delhi, he telephoned me and said that this guy is sitting under water for 3 days. Why don't you go and see this thing? I've gone with him. And then I found that there's in a park, it was all covered with the tarpaulin. No one can see whether it's actually sitting in the water or not. But he actually went down, then it was covered, then water was pumped in. Several, water tanks were brought in and it was all, pumped down in people's presence. But it's covered, you cannot see that thing. So I requested, why don't you just open and show us? He said, no, no. He's in meditation. Meditation is a very special position that if he's shaken now, he'll die then immediately. Therefore, you cannot open because he wants absolute tranquility. Therefore, he sits there. I, as usual, I look for the person who worked on this thing. And I found the mason who worked the little hall here visiting. And he told me that there were two drainage lines in that, which has a closure. So when your pipe is put down, you can simply connect it to one line and the water simply will go through that line. And there's another, then he can cover it. Any moment you want water, you can again put in water and the water will be there. It's a very easily controllable with one valve closure. So I knew this thing and I came to the press conference and I said, I'm sure that he's not sitting under water, but must be reading newspapers. So. Then the fourth day or fifth day when he comes out, a huge crowd, 5,000 people there. And there were a lot of journalists at all. And then again, fresh water was pumped in. Of course, this time the line is closed because one should see water. Then it's opened and there was water and he was 40, not under. Then he comes out, straight away go to a high stage and start a great lecture. The great lecture was against me, basically. He said, because I was very active in the media, making press conferences and all. There is one guy, he's making a lot of sound these days. And he says that nobody can sit 4 days under water. But he does not know, in his mother's uterus, he remained 9 months in water. That's possible. You have to imagine that thing. But his name also, I can say with my power, his name is Sajal Iramaruga. That's not my name exactly. My name is Sanam. Then suddenly I remembered, I was not that popular like now. One newspaper, Times of India, published my name with the wrong spelling. He actually was reading newspaper with the wrong spelling. But meantime I saw that the water was going down because it was all loose. Then I showed the journalists how the water was going down and it was explained and all. He saw me there. And then, the next shouting was very simple. The rationalist there, kill him. That was the shouting. And nobody really knows my face at that time. Therefore, I just blended into the crowd and walked coolly. And my car was ready, driver was waiting with the open door. Just walked in and I just went to the press conference and I made a press conference asking him to come to the press conference, we provide a glass chamber, visibly seen from outside. He need not see for 4 days, just 40 minutes. And we will be very happy. And then one journalist asked, what will you do? I said, I will become, rest of my life is disabled if you do that thing, if he survives, of course. But he has not come to Delhi to accept this challenge. Through another side, he has left Delhi. And he never came to Delhi, but later he came in another place, in Uttar Pradesh, and came in a burying under the earth. I didn't leave him. I went to television there and waited outside. And then I found, carefully I watched and found that there was a little corrugated sheet on the side. Later, when the crowd went down, I moved the television. This is from actual television scene. I just jumped out, just to move this thing. And there was a he was claiming that he's sitting down completely under the mud and earth and buried down. But this was removed, this was corrugated because it was to breathe properly. And then when it was removed, he was sitting down like this. This is also from the television clipping. He was just sitting down on a sheet, and this is just like a very comfortable room. And that's how this guy is over now, finished. But you know, it's like Hydra, more and more people come out. And again, 2 years back, this guy came, Prahlad Jani. Imagine, this all started in 1960s. Prahlad Jani suddenly came in the Indian scene. Nobody has heard of him earlier. 2-3 years back he came. He said that he did not eat food or drink water. 5 minutes more, okay. For 70 years. And the claim was taken damn serious. Damn serious means, you know, he was immediately very faint. Not that if he does it, but how he does it. And if you know the technique of how he is doing it, government of India thought at that time that this technique can be taught to the soldiers at the borders, because no food token is necessary anymore. Because at Siachen, very difficult to drop food for the soldiers there. All people going in space need not take water and food because one can have this meditation technique. So, the Indian defense, of course, I mean, this, I challenged this thing and got this information that there was urine in the bladder. It has gone. So then the hospital explains that the urine is recycled into the body. A lot of strange claims came. I completely challenged it in the television. The defense department gave you $80 million worth of money to study about this technique. 2 years back. It comes from an idea that people can live in the sunlight. But we got him also later, in a restaurant eating. But still more government come. There's another guy who understands the mechanism, who advises, Nirmal Baba is his name. He says he advises simple things like change your belt if you're wearing a black belt, change it to a green belt or a blue belt, or if you are eating a special chutney for your food, change the chutney, then all blessing would go. But when you get a blessing of the success in your business or something like that, you have to pay 1/10 of your entire income from that day to his private account. He advertised in 43 channels, and of course he got now a hotel chain purchased in his own name. I've been trying to expose this guy during my hiding time. Why I wasn't hiding, in the next 3 minutes I'll tell you. This is another Gautman who claims that he was the incarnation of Vishnu, the last avatar. This is like, the other show some images to show the different sizes of India. Annual Kumbh, where the naked sadhus who live in the controlled areas go there, or the psychopaths. This is the exoticized India, the other side, or the angry holy men, or you know, people at the burial grounds doing special magic. These all are part of exoticization of India. Why India produces a lot of software engineers and scientific technology going on, and we are addressing our problems with science and technology at our side. This is all going. But we counter it. This is a documentary by Channel 4, the Guru Busters. In 1995, we went into Indian villages. Along with some other guys, we went into 1,000 villages in 18 months in 100 districts. reaching out, it's a roadshow, reaching out people, explaining the miracles, I mean, all this body mass business directly. And this is, give this documentary on that, in the first of it. These all are young rationalists or skeptics doing the same thing as gurus do. But all fire walking in temples, we engraving, but this is a trained skeptic only walking on the fire and showing how it is done. Or national science center, like trained youngsters, but limited, not like Mahesh Yogi would do. But here is really in front of you, children would levitate. But the levitation is so simple that the boy has a hockey stick in his hand. And he holds it like this only and sits like this. But he's trained and it looks real. That's how body will do it. So, but the students have tried to do that. And they would go back to their schools and still teach more students. And then these strange boys and girls join us in the village campaigns, where such things are publicly discussed with people. This is a campaign which goes everywhere, so actively. But sometimes, you know the story,
yeah.
Where the polyman wanted to kill me. So from village to village, we have been moving in the 90s. Now it has changed to television studio to studio. I attend nearly 200 television programs a year, on an average. So one of these programs, this guy wanted to kill me with magic and a different part of the film here. You can see this in YouTube, Tantra Challenge, you can see. this is what happened in last March. The statue of Jesus Christ, crucifix, the water started dropping here. So as usual, I've been asked to study about this thing by some channels and I've gone there. The first thing I noticed was on the back, the wall was wet. And algae was there. Nobody notices this thing. And then I found that here is the crucifix. Look, here is water. And there is somewhere water was climbing, there is no water source at the top. And I found there was a toilet behind that. And it had a leaking water at the top. And then I found that there was a drainage line going, and then I opened this thing. It was completely clogged water there, it was stinking like anything, unbearably stinking. And when I reached there, there was a prayer going on, and nearly 300 people were there. And the priest stops the prayer and distributes the holy water to everybody, a spoonful. Hold on your palm and and that was just dirty toilet water. I went out and I came here and I found that, I mean, this is the point, you know, when it climbs up, here is a breaking of paint and the capillary action is working and the, like on the wall, climb here also, but here it rained out and simply fell down from there. Here it was bright and here it was wet. I touched that. I have to use, you know, after that, believe it or not, I keep this thing with me, the sanitization thing, because I was so afraid of water after that. Still for several days. Of course, I collected some water from there, sent for a chemical analysis, and found the coliform bacteria content was 800 million times more than human tolerance. So just toilet stuff. And of course, then I tried to they wanted me to explain it there, but I did not really explain, but come in the television discuss. The bishop himself comes to dispense the miracle, to keep the argument, and he says that I've hurt the religious sentiments by exposing this miracle. He wanted to punish me, and he said that you have to remember that Galileo, who opposed our church, apologized. And you have to apologize. And I said, I don't do that thing. I mean, even if you burn me, I mean, that's not possible. I don't do that. Even now, this bishop publicly makes, they have made 17 cases against me for exposing this miracle. Using a draconian law of India, which has nothing to do with miracle, but a malicious intention hurting somebody's religious sentiments, that's a law. It's a law which has no meaning. In 1860, this law came. And in this law, once a police station registers this case, there is no way that you can come out. You need not go to a court of law, but you can ask, you can be arrested. It's not bailable because it's cognizable, non-bailable. The only remedy is that you have to go for an anticipatory bail. I tried that thing, but the anticipatory bail does not work because the court says, go to this court and I go to Mumbai court, and Mumbai court says go to local court. So it looks like that I could be arrested any moment. If I'm arrested, as per this law, only when it comes to a court of law I can defend myself. But he can wait 3 years if they want, because the guy is under the control of the bishop, it's very clear, the police officer. Because 15 police stations rejected outrightly this complaint, but only 2 police stations accepted this thing. state there under the control of the state. So if I am arrested, I can be simply be in 3 years in prison without a trial. And at the end of it, they can say that, oh, it was a wrong case, we don't file it.
3 years.
2 years, after 3 years. But 3 years, why 3 years is one way I have, I can come on. Because at that time I can say that if I am convicted, I would get only 3 years. So I have already passed 3 years. I can go to the court, they will argue against me. Maybe it can go another 3-4 years. So that's the legal structure in India. I was about to make a lecture tour in Poland at that time. So 10 days earlier, I just came out. I thought, when I'm abroad, my lawyers should work on the anticipatory bail and I should get an anticipatory bail. But once the police comes to arrest you, there is no possibility of an anticipatory bail. Meantime, when I was out, I heard that police is already at the home to arrest me. And now, there's a lot of discussion going on in the televisions and media and all. There are more than 180 articles in the print media, all supporting me. Televisions are arguing for me, some, and all India televisions. Not a single article, not a single television program I see supporting the charge. But the system does not seem to be working. I do not know what is happening. There is a law reforms committee in India. I mean, appraiser to that thing. Including this particular law, which is misused so heavily, is under scrutiny of government of India for modification. But the law is used against me now. And I don't see any solution now at this moment than making public pressure from India and from outside. Internationally, we are doing it properly, and India, we are making a lot of pressure. Now, the bishop has come out some weeks back, said that, well, we can end up the whole thing. Only what he has to do is he should make an apology. And I made a very strict statement that, no, I don't apologize. Rather, I would only say that when you withdraw the case unconditionally, you need not apologize, because I can forgive you, because you do not know what you are doing. So that's why I'm here. Okay. If you have any questions.
Una pregunta es breve porque hay 4:20 como mucho. Porque cierra
bien. Bueno, I wanted to say that unfortunately in Spain we have the same law. If you do a blasphemy or if you insult the religious feelings of somebody, you can actually get a fine, a really, really expensive fine.
Yeah. You know, in India, the whole problem, this kind of laws are existing all over Europe, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've been in Ireland, 2 weeks back. Ireland has a new blasphemy law. The first, the only blasphemy law that is enacted, or made as a law, the 21st century is in Ireland. In a modern Western country, this law was made. Of course, it's a very complicated law. But now the present government wants to get away from that. So, in a way, they supported my visit also. The foreign minister was very active, supporting me a lot. Because then I was given an opportunity to talk to the senators also when I reached there. And I was told that, they are going to make changes in the blasphemy law in Ireland now. Why? Because the blasphemy laws are, it's not really used in Western Europe nowadays. But it's coming as a very big blow in the United Nations, because the Islamic countries are asking for a new blasphemy law, like a universal declaration of human rights, that nobody should be able to criticize any prophet or any holy man or anybody connected to religion. They want to have a guarantee like that internationally. And now in Pakistan, for example, if a mentally ailing girl by mistake tears a page of the Quran, she would be executed. Ironically, you know, the people who says that a law is a law in a television program in CNN last week, I found that one of the accusers against me say that a law is a law, we will implement it at any cost. But the very same guys are arguing in Pakistan that this law is not a law, it should go. Because somebody from Christian communities in Tamil there. What we say is that it's not a question of Christianity or Islam or anybody. In a civilized world, such laws are not meaningful. the free speech is one of the greatest values that we have. Criticism and freedom to make joke at anything, that's important because, you know, polemics is one way of criticism, understanding things. I mean, the way of self-criticism starts from there. If you stop caricatures and cartoonists and critics, I mean, things don't work in the world because that's one of the greatest values that we have. You may not agree to most of the criticism, but let there be criticism, let people feel a little hurt about things. We should allow people to have a little hurt feeling and defend themselves. And that's the way intellectual climate should develop. Therefore, the blasphemy laws have to go everywhere. That's my effort now. I'm no more concerned about my personal security because if I want to go back and join my family, I can just make a small apology privately. They even offered that they would not make it public, they can make a private apology also. I don't do that thing because what I feel is that this is a larger issue to be taken to the world, that such laws have to go, and we have to see that one of the major achievements that we have made in the free speech and free expression should be defended, and that's very important for this world.
Me sorprende que, siendo la India un país con tantos gurús, tantos santones, que le haya hecho la denuncia y ha sido una asociación católica. O sea, con la cantidad de enemigos que ha podido hacer en 30 años de trabajo, sea precisamente la Iglesia Católica la que finalmente haya puesto.
He's saying he's really surprised that with the whole history of India, how many gurus and Gopman and people that you have been fighting, that it's precisely the Catholic Church, the one that starts a real issue against.
Yeah, that is really surprising me also. For example, I went to Satish Sai Baba, and at one time we had the President of India, the Prime Minister of India, the Speaker of India, the Chief Justice of India, Supreme Court, top businessmen, all the cricket stars. This makes the whole India. They were all supporters of Satish Sai Baba. And when they all go to Satish Sai Baba's birthday, on 80th birthday, and when he produces holy ash and all these kind of things, I could go to some other television channel. And one major television channel invites me and I have 1 hour panel discussion, make a lot of jokes about Satish Sai Baba, and simply say that I really feel bad that my Prime Minister, my President goes there and gives credence to this guy. He's wrong, he's a fraudster, he's a trickster. I could publicly say it. That was India, free India. And freedom of speech is guaranteed in the constitution, one of the fundamental rights. And fundamental duty, there is another clause, where promotion of scientific temper, critical inquiry, and spirit of inquiry and reform is my duty as per Indian constitution. So at one side, I'm invited to the National Science Center to promote and educate people. Or Science and Technology Ministry sends rationalist volunteers or trainees to, I mean, inspire science camps at the other side. On the other side, such a law. See, all these holy men I was criticizing, all these holy men, but I was never making any hatred speech. Never ever in my life, I never made any hatred speech. See, last 30 years I have been in public field, and never a single accusation against me that I have just hatred speech. I am an atheist, I don't believe in any gods or anything. But I consider myself, my position is my position, and I don't accuse other people of having any belief. I would normally say that I believe in free speech and freedom of belief, faith, worship, and everything I believe in. And that's how it should be in a civilized society. Like I have my freedom not to believe, and somebody else has the freedom to believe in a statue or any miracle also you can believe. I have the right to say that it's absurd. He has the right to say that, look, that's my belief, I believe in that thing, I don't stop him. That's how a civilized society should work. But this approach was, that's why when I went to 1,000 villages, not a single place there was ever attacked. Other people have been coming and hugging us. That kind of an approach I've developed. I mean, I've been putting it maximum positive way. I mean, not in a hatred level at all. But when here in this discussion also, if you see the clipping, when the bishop is telling that you are ignorant, we will punish you, I laugh from it. I thought laughter is my best weapon. I just laugh. And they say that you can accuse that thing, but I have no problem. I don't say that you are ignorant. But I think you have to read some books, at least history books. Because he even said that, Galileo was one of the statements the bishop made was science and technology has developed in Europe because of Catholic Church promoting it.
They say it here as well. They sometimes.
I would not like to comment on that thing, but I would like to bring two witnesses from history to come to that thing. That's how the Galileo came. I said one would be Giordano Bruno, who would vouch for me that we're wrong. He is, I mean, awakened and brought in, and Galileo Galilei. And he said, but Galileo, you know, he apologized.
And was buried for 100 years. I actually have two questions. Every that the big one is like, is the Vatican making any statement about this? Because in such a case, it should be like even bad publicity for them to be arguing by this side. And the second one very quickly is like, can this public church be brought by public hazard or some any kind of health issue that they are having with this kind of distribution of the water? I mean, in
The first part is very interesting. Both the questions are important and interesting. The Vatican, for example, the Pope here in Europe, he speaks that free speech is to be guaranteed. Okay, read one of his statements. But when it comes to India, he didn't want it. Of course, the Vatican has some problems with it. One problem was when John Paul visited India. Probably these things are working hard now. It has a lot of backlog. When John Paul visited India, he made a huge mass, and at the end of the mass he made a public speech. He made. He said, the first millennium we harvested faith in Europe. Second millennium we harvested faith in Americas and Africas. Third millennium, we are seeing to it that we harvest faith in Asia, especially in India. So I counted it, of course. I mean, I don't speak such things. I sat in 2 hours later in our television program. I was invited. I said that you would not allow it, very simply. You would counter it and resist it, the most powerful weapon of history, which is known as common sense. Very simple like that. And this was not taken very kindly. They were very angry. Also, when recently they made a saint, Sister Alfonsa, that was in a district where I was born and grew up. In Kottayam, but the largest Catholic concentration is there. This poor nun died a normal death because of some ailment at the age of 40 or something like that. Suddenly she becomes a saint. Why? Because somebody claims that a lame boy walks over the burial place and he walks downstairs. But no, the neighbors say that he otherwise also walked normally, no problem was there. But that was taken as a big argument and all. Then there are nearly 200 Catholic schools are there in this district. All girls there are dressed up as nuns and walked in the streets. The church gave them nun dress. I wrote an article in the topmost weekly in India named the Outlook magazine. My article was non exportable. But it said it was a very simple argument. There are, I know these figures you must be also knowing, the nuns, number of nuns in the world are going down dramatically. Nobody wants to be a nun anymore. In America, the average age of a nun is 70 years. And in Europe, nobody wants to become a nun, except maybe in Poland. Now the 55% of the entire nuns work in the churches all around Europe are coming from India. And you know, nunnery is a very big business for them because they all sign for their salaries and never get the money. And now, 95% of the nuns going from India are coming from this tiny district of Kottayam. And there they make one nun as a saint and dress up all young girls as nuns. What does it mean? I said, this is a recruitment drive started very early. And these things, you know, go very deep into the mindset of these people. And of course, they are looking for an opportunity, apparently. And that could be one reason that I could see. The second thing could be a little more serious political. The Catholic Church, though Sonia Gandhi, the president of Congress Party, is coming from a Roman Catholic family from Italy. She married one prime minister of India. And Rajiv Gandhi's widow. She's not, I don't think she's a practicing Roman Catholic at any case. But the bishops try to make a lot of clout, showing that she is a Roman Catholic and we have an access to power. That must be one reason which could be an undercurrent of the power politics. The other question regarding Pope is very interesting. One possibility is that, you know, one stage they would feel the heat too much and they would simply withdraw the case. That's almost, they cannot go with it, very clear. Because now they want to, a face-saving escape route, and that's why they want me to apologize. And maybe some other day they would say that, oh, we have forgiven him, we have withdrawn the case. They could simply say. That's one possibility. Maybe Pope, or because Vatican, they are good policy makers for the keeping of the church running properly, and they may try to do that thing. Other thing they would say that, oh, this got it and this guy is now away from India, and we are free and we can do whatever we want, which we don't allow. Because even in my absence, nothing stops in India. Only I am personally attacked with one case. The organization is ever active than earlier. I have every second day Skype conference with our national council. And every state organization has been permanent communication with. Everybody is so active and vigil now. And I feel enormously happy with another thing, which I never thought earlier. Because I always had a fear that I am a very active person. I've been very active in the movement. I know my energy level. Sometimes I feel that if when I go from this life, what would suddenly happen? Can there be a gap in the whole movement? This is one thing that was worrying me. But this is a given chance now, the church. So that now I trained a lot of people who can go ahead, even in my absence, and I guide them properly. And it's a very good feeling that I have that, yes, in my absence also things will go. It won't stop. They would realize it very soon. That's what I hope. There are two ways only. They have to withdraw the case, or the government of India has to change the law. That's also being demanded. If you go to IBN channel and all, most of the channels are demanding, and all made lawyers and experts are all are coming to showing my case as an example. They are asking for a legislation to change this law, 1860 law.
Hay mucho tiempo, así que pienso que podríamos dejarlo aquí. Damos un fuerte aplauso. Buena suerte. Y nada, por último, quiero que te hable con un expositor de Gilgamesh, que...